Next, I'll present some intuitive examples. These examples are quite intuitive and helpful. I hope you can take a look. In this grid world example, it's a 5x5 grid with a total of 25 states. First, we have a policy, which is depicted by the arrows. This policy is exploratory because it assigns the same probability of 0.2 to each of the 5 actions. What we need to do next is to estimate the state value of this policy. Essentially, this is a policy evaluation problem. If I use a tabular method that we learned in previous lectures, I need to store 25 state values. However, if I use the TD linear method introduced just now, we can use fewer parameters to approximate these 25 state values quite well. These are some parameters for this example. Let's first take a look at the ground truth of the state values. The ground truth can be obtained by solving the Bellman equation. Then we can use the TD linear method to compare and see if it can accurately estimate the state values. To better illustrate the state values, we can replot this 2D table as a 3D surface. This 3D surface has its horizontal and vertical axes corresponding to the horizontal and vertical axes in the table. For example, this point, which is the lowest point on the surface, corresponds to the coordinates 1, 5. It corresponds to this cell at 1, 5, and its value is negative 4.5, which is also the smallest value in the entire table. So, what is the basic idea behind using TD linear? The idea is to obtain a function, and this function corresponds to a surface. The surface should be as close as possible to this complex surface. This is the fundamental idea. To achieve this goal, we need data. Since we don't have a model, we need data. Here, the data consists of 500 episodes, with each episode having 500 steps. The state action pair at the start of each episode is randomly selected and follows a uniform distribution. We first use the data and the tabular TD algorithm we learned earlier to compute state values. We refer to this tabular TD algorithm as TD table. The surface plot of the final state values obtained by TD table is shown here. You can see that it is very close to the earlier 3D surface. The right figure also shows that as we use more episodes, up to 500 episodes in the end, the error in the state value estimation gradually reduces to zero. Next, let's see if TD linear can also estimate the state values well. The first step in using TD linear is to establish the feature vector. Note the idea here, as I mentioned earlier, we want to establish a function, and this function corresponds to a surface. The surface should fit the actual state value well. So, what is the simplest case of a function corresponding to a surface? The answer is a plane. Therefore, in this case, we choose the feature vector to be 1xy. Then, the function v hat sw equals phi transpose sw. The final result is w1 plus w2x plus w3y, which is evidently a plane in 3D space, where w1, w2, and w3 are its parameters. The order of the elements in the feature vector can be adjusted, it doesn't matter. Then let's substitute the feature vector we just defined into the TD linear algorithm. This is the true state value, and this is the state value learned by TD linear. As you can see, the trend is correct. The values on the left are generally smaller, while those on the right are generally larger. However, the state value estimates at many specific points are not very accurate. This can also be seen on the right side. Although it eventually converges, the final convergence error is not zero. Why is this? It's quite simple. The surface of the true state value is complex, but now I want to use a plane to fit it. How is that possible? It's impossible to achieve a perfect fit. This is exactly what I mentioned earlier. If we want to fit it well, we can't use a simple plane. We need to use a more complex higher order surface. The corresponding feature vector will also need to be of higher order and have more parameters. Now let's see if we can do this. Here we choose a feature vector phi s equals 1xyx squared y squared xy. Compared to the previous feature vector, this new feature vector has quadratic terms for x and y, so the order is higher. The corresponding function v hat is this, which includes quadratic terms in x and y. Therefore, the corresponding surface is a quadratic surface. Compared to the previous plane, this surface can fit the surface of true state values better. We can further increase the dimension of the feature vector and the number of parameters. For example, we could add the cubic terms of x and y. The corresponding v hat would then be a more complex surface in three-dimensional space, and its fitting ability would be stronger. Let's take a look at the figures. This is the result of fitting with a quadratic surface using the TD linear algorithm. As you can see, the trend is also correct, and in some areas it can fit better than before. For example, this point is the lowest point. If we fit it with a cubic surface, the results will be even better. Visually, this surface is already very close to the surface of true state values. From the numerical values, we can also tell that the final convergence error is small. Through these examples, I believe you can better understand value function methods. We saw that using more parameters will result in better fitting. However, there is a trade-off: the number of parameters cannot be too many. If there are too many parameters, the value function method eventually becomes no different from the tabular method. More importantly, in the linear case, it doesn't mean that continuously increasing the number of parameters can eventually reduce the final fitting error to zero. Why? Because it's still a linear function. Since the structure of the function is fixed, even if there are a lot of parameters, its fitting ability is still limited by the function's structure. This is also one of the reasons why neural networks are widely used today. Theoretically, neural networks can approximate any nonlinear function. For more explanations of these examples and choices of feature vectors, you can refer to my book. Now, let's summarize the contents we just learned. So far, we've learned the idea of value function methods. Let's review it again. First, we start with an objective function, which looks like this. It's a weighted average of the squared error between the true state value and the estimated state value. Then, we optimize this objective function using the gradient descent algorithm. This is the corresponding gradient descent algorithm. The problem here is that we don't know the value of vpi. So what do? We can replace vpi with this term, and the algorithm becomes the one that combines TD learning with value function approximation. This is the storyline of the whole process. What information do I want to convey here? This story is very intuitive and can help you easily understand the fundamental idea. However, it's not mathematically rigorous. Why? Because I made a substitution here, and this substitution might be problematic. Strictly speaking, this algorithm isn't strictly minimizing the original objective function, but rather another objective function. I will talk about this later in this lecture. While it is not rigorous, why do I use this storyline to introduce value function methods? That is because if I didn't use this storyline, the problem would become much more complex. I would either have to directly present the algorithm or the objective function that the algorithm actually optimizes, both of which are very complicated. So for most readers, it's already sufficient to grasp this storyline. If you're particularly interested in the storyline that is more rigorous, you can refer to my book for the theoretical analysis. Next, let me quickly go through the storyline that is more rigorous with just a few slides. The basic conclusion is that the algorithm we just presented doesn't actually minimize the objective function we mentioned earlier. So, what does it minimize? Let's take a look. In fact, there are multiple objective functions. The first one is the one we just discussed. We can write it in a simplified form as a vector v hat and v pi, where each element of the vector corresponds to each state. The double vertical lines represent the vector norm. The D in the subscript represents a matrix weight. In particular, a vector xd squared is equal to x transpose times dx. Here, the diagonal elements of this D are actually the state's probability distribution, which is represented by d pi. In summary, this is the objective function we have discussed earlier. In addition to this objective function, there's another one called the Bellman error. What does this mean? It means that we want v hat to approximate v pi. V pi satisfies the equation v pi equals r pi plus gamma p pi v pi, which is the Bellman equation. If v hat equals v pi, then v hat should also satisfy this equation. V hat equals r pi plus gamma p pi v hat. This can be written as a function t pi v hat. In theory, they should be equal. If they are not equal, then we minimize this error, which is called the Bellman error. Beyond this, there's another objective function, which is what the algorithm actually aims to minimize. What is it? It's the projected Bellman error. It includes the previous part, but with an additional projection matrix. What does this mean? It means that these two quantities might never be equal because the function you're using might not be able to perfectly approximate vpi. For example, if the function is a plane, as we discussed in the previous example, it can never perfectly approximate vpi no matter how we optimize its parameters. So we can multiply this quantity by a projection matrix. What space does it project onto? It projects onto the space consisting of all possible v-hat. In this case, the error can be optimized to be zero. In summary, the TD linear algorithm we just discussed minimizes this projected Bellman error. I will not talk about more details about it in this lecture because there are many. If you're interested, you can refer to my book for more theoretical analysis.